There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker. We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker?
Greetings, Slasherholics. Welcome to episode 8 of Out of Print Slashers. I am your co-host, Sean Campbell. I am here with the 80s Slasher Librarian, Josh LaRue. How are you doing tonight?
Doing good, Sean. What are we going to talk about tonight?
Tonight, we are doing the novelization of Jason X by Pat Cadigan, and she would go on to do the second book in the series, Jason X, The Experiment, and then it would get handed off to Nancy Kilpatrick, who would do the third and fifth one with Alex Johnson doing the fabled, terrifying Death Moon. I'm sure you're just excited to be on that one, huh?
Oh, God. That's gonna be a fun episode. Tonight's episode is brought to you by Out of Ideas Incorporated. Out of Ideas. Just put it in space.
Yeah. See, you know, it's interesting that we're doing Jason X because, I mean, I know I've probably mentioned in other podcasts we've done, Jason X is how I found your channel.
I love Jason X. It's, you know, I might have just said that little joke about put it in space, but I love Jason X. Go ahead.
Well, I was just saying that I was reading some article that was talking about horror things you've never heard of, and it was like, yeah, Jason went to space in the 10th Friday the 13th, and then it had four sequels in the after the book novelization, and I was looking to find it, and I couldn't afford it. Then I found your channel, and then we eventually start talking and do this. But, you know, I'm really excited to do Jason X. It actually, Jason X might have been, like, the 11th horror movie I've ever seen in my life. I had only seen two Jason movies before this, the first Friday the 13th, and then Jason
and that's
X.
And that's not even technically a Jason movie.
Yeah, I mean you're right there. I mean,
I could have seen Jason X like a year before it hit theaters because it was like on the internet and because it leaked. That's why it did so crappy at the box office, because it leaked online like a year before it hit theaters.
That ruined a lot of movies.
Yeah, well, they set on this movie for like 3 years. It was in the can, ready to go. They set on it, and they were waiting to get a little bit closer to Freddy versus Jason.
Yeah, and there's a whole story behind that we can explore in that episode.
Yeah, and so I went and saw this movie in theaters, man, and I loved it. There was a few people groaning, but most of like the hardcore horror fans that went really enjoyed the movie. Some people clapped at the end, so I don't understand all the hate for it. I've got a theory on the hate for this movie, and that is, over the years, a lot of people's like, oh, Jason in space, it's got to suck because it's in space. And then other people, like younger people that may have not even known about the movie until like Friday the 13th, the video game came out, they just see these other people talking about how it sucks, so they just want to, you know, sound like everybody else, sound like they know what they're talking about. So they're like, yeah, Jason X sucks. It's in space. I have a feeling a lot of people that say it sucks either have only seen the movie one time, like a long time ago, haven't seen it at all, or just don't take the time to really look at what Jason X is and appreciate it. Because at the core of Jason X, Sean, is the formula, the formula of a Friday the 13th movie. It's all there. It just happens to be on a spaceship in the future. You know,
exactly.
you got your teens in, away from civilization, very limited adult supervision once all the military people, you know, get killed. But even then, they're not, like, older. They're, you know, in, like, their 20s. So, I don't know. It felt just like any other Friday the 13th movie to me, just a little more exciting because it was, the stakes were a little higher. There was nowhere to escape to.
Yeah, it's just, I'll never forget seeing this movie. See, back where I was living, it was a very limited selection in the video section. There was only like 3 Friday the 13th movies, and this happened to be one of them. And I was fascinated by the cover. I don't know if you remember this cover, but there's a machete in the middle with a screaming woman in the reflection. Yes. One half is the Jason mask, and then the other half is this metal cyborg looking thing. And I'm like, are there 2 Jasons? Are they gonna fight? What's going on? There's so much going on in this poster. I love the colors. I had to see it. And then starting out watching it, I was fascinated from the beginning to the end. I mean, it was a little cheesy when it needed to be, but it's actually kind of more serious than you would think. I mean, compared to Leprechaun 4 in space, this one's probably a serious drama compared to that one.
You know, it doesn't take itself too seriously. There's enough drama there. The stakes are there. The stakes are higher because there's no, you know, there's nowhere to escape to. Their one oasis gets destroyed. But I think the movie knows it's cheesy in parts and it runs with it. And it makes it more entertaining. You know, it knows it's kind of a parody of itself, really. It's a fun movie. Not once was I bored during this movie. I loved it. It's a great slasher flick. It has the best kill in the entire series in this movie.
You're talking about the liquid nitrogen, aren't you?
Of course, yes.
I think if everybody, even if people that don't like this movie, people that like this movie, I feel like everyone can agree that was a pretty awesome kill.
And you already know how I feel about the people that say, well, they didn't even try with Kane Hodder. He's like got his hair sprouting back out before he's Uber Jason. They didn't even try to give us a cool looking Jason. And I'm like, you know, anybody who's listened knows, my theory is he's been in custody so long, he's not taking damage constantly, so he's regenerating back, you know?
I always just think that every director wants to completely change the way Jason looks. And I feel that when this movie opened up, that didn't bother me. I mean, because you got to think, sometimes he's a little skinnier, sometimes he has extra clothing on, sometimes he's more rotten than others. I mean, in the 9th one, his head was all bulbous with the mask growing into it. I mean, I think Jason with hair is not the craziest thing I've seen Jason come out of. I mean, I didn't think it was that bad.
He had hair in part 2, and he actually had hair in part 9, you know, a little strand of it. And he had Freddy versus Jason. He had a little bit of hair coming out. Of course, that came after. Sean Cunningham actually returned to help out with Jason Goes to Hell and Jason X. He hadn't really done nothing with the series since Friday the 13th one, other than just get paid, you know.
And not just him. Harry Manfredini, who did the music for most of the series, came back to do this. So you got to think, a lot of the original people are coming back. Kane Hodder's coming back. The composer's coming back. It very much feels like a Friday the 13th movie. It's just in space, and I just don't think that's that big of a deal. No. I mean,
you know, I love Jason Goes to Hell and Jason X, and I really don't care for, like, Takes Manhattan. I love every Jason movie, but some of them I just don't love as much.
Yeah.
And Part 8, probably my least favorite, because, well,
Jason takes a cruise ship, rather.
Exactly. Jason takes a cruise ship to Canada and calls it New York. But at least with Jason Goes to Hell and Jason X, they tried something new, and they didn't just give us the same old, same old. And all these people complaining about space, what did you want? Did you want it to be exact same movie that we saw 7 times? Or did you want them to take the formula of the movie and give us something fresh and exciting? Because that's what I enjoyed about it.
Well, it could have been much, much worse. I heard some ideas floating around for this movie that it was going to be Jason Goes NASCAR. There was a script that he was going to go to an abandoned USSR submarine. There was a couple ideas floating around there. So, I mean, we could have got Jason Takes NASCAR. That would have been equally as interesting. There was one, I think, it might have been Jeffrey Thomas that was floating around the casino idea.
Yeah, he was going to write a book about if he had got one of the... if he could have written one of the Jason books for Black Flame, it was going to take place in a huge casino.
Ooh, I think that would have been more akin to Hate Kill Repeat.
Yeah,
where they're in the hotel.
Yeah, I love that ending of Hate Kill Repeat. I can't wait to talk about that book. There's a lot going on in that book. Some of it I don't like, some of it I really enjoyed. But, so we talked about how we feel about Jason X, the movie. And let's talk about the novelization of Jason X by Pat Cadigan.
Okay.
She is a good author. I want to get that out right off the beginning. She's a great author. She does a great job with the novelization. And she actually comes back and writes the direct sequel to the movie and the novelization, Jason X 2, The Experiment, which has it's kind of a polarizing book, really. It's got its ups, and it isn't usually how a book like that works, because usually, and we'll talk more about this experiment when we get there, but would you agree, Sean, that usually a book starts out slow and ends kind of, at least with Black Plain, they start out slow, end in high gear, and then The Experiment kind of does the opposite?
Nah, kind of debatable. I mean, Hell Lake started out in hell. But that one's kind of an oddity in and of itself.
Well, he didn't stay on a table for half the book, though, in Hell Lake. But yeah, that one kind of started out in high gear. You got a good point there. But anyways, my point is, Pat Cadigan wrote the novelization and the direct sequel to Jason X. And I thought that was interesting that they kept the same author to write the novelization and the direct sequel. Because the sequel picks up exactly at the same spot where Jason X, the movie, and the book leaves off. Sadly, Jason X, the novelization, doesn't offer many extras.
I mean, it does add a couple things. There are more characters that get backstory. There are a couple things that happened that are actually explained in the book. And one example of
Yes. Yeah, I know where you're going. Yeah, I love this. Go ahead.
The very beginning of the book. I mean, if you remember the movie, Jason is chained in place, and there's an IV tube running into his neck, and this grunt comes over, this military person that's supposed to guard him, and is like, "I don't like you looking at me," and throws a blanket over his face, and that's it. Yep. Well, in the book, they show that when he did that, he knocked out the IV tube,
and then all that
stuff that was keeping him sedated, he's now awake, and that's what starts this entire movie/book. And I feel like the movie didn't show that. I mean, I'm sure there was a reason Jason wasn't moving, but the fact that the book explains that, I thought that was actually refreshing.
Yeah, because in the movie, it's like, why did he wait for a blanket to get thrown over? If he could have gotten loose this whole time, why didn't he? And it was refreshing that the book went into detail. I feel like that was in the script, and maybe whenever they were shooting it, maybe they shot a scene, that was like part of that scene, but they were like cutting scenes down a little bit just to make the movie flow better, and the scene of the needle coming out, you know, just got cut.
But, I mean, that isn't the first time that happens. I mean, there are a lot of movies that when they get cut down for time, there's a little piece of the movie that was vital that just gets lost by the wayside.
Yeah. It happens a lot, sadly. I love whenever we get director's cuts and deleted scenes on these kind of movies. So let's play a clip for everybody of that scene.
Okay, roll it.
But then, as stupid and bored as he had let felt guarding a hole in the ground, it had only been a hole in the ground, not an abyss. Of course, the Grand Canyon was only a hole in the ground compared to what he was staring at this moment. And if you gaze for long into an abyss, the abyss gazes also into you. Never had Schmoll Chaim Johnson understood the essence of these words so well as he did at this moment. His grandfather, the original Schmoll Chaim, had once told him that with understanding came wisdom, which in turn elevated the human spirit and brought man closer to Yahuwah. It was obvious to young Sam Johnson that his Zaid had never laid eyes on anything like Jason Voorhees. This monster had nothing to do with wisdom or the elevation of the human spirit, and certainly wasn't related to anything godly. It was the pure antithesis of godly. It was the debasement of humankind, endowed with brutality, not wisdom, and wasn't interested in either understanding or being understood. It sure made him wonder about Nietzsche, though. If Nietzsche had come face to face with this sort of thing back in the day, then Johnson felt very sorry for him indeed. However, Johnson hoped that wasn't the case. He didn't like knowing that he had read anything written by someone capable of only imagining the abyss. A person who could do that wouldn't have to fight a monster to become one. Either way, Johnson decided he wasn't going to waste any pity on Nietzsche. The son of a bitch was dead. His troubles were over. He didn't have to stand guard duty for an abyss, gazing at it, and having it gaze back at him, literally. Johnson knew the thing was looking at him. There was a glint in its single remaining eye from the only bright light in the room, which shone directly down on where it stood on a small round dais. If it had blinked, Johnson had missed it. The thing was completely motionless and silent, wrapped in a straitjacket that had been modified to accommodate two sets of heavy chains, one set coming down from the ceiling, the other bolted to the floor around the platform. But in case that wasn't enough, and from what Johnson knew, it definitely wasn't. The medics had set up an IV with an industrial-strength tranquilizer and plugged it right into the thing's neck. The clear bag dangling from the metal tree behind the thing was easily three times the size of a normal IV bag, and the medics had strict orders not to let the fluid inside sink lower than the one-quarter mark before they changed it for a full one. The medics had changed the bag twice since Johnson had been on duty, both times well before the fluid fell to the minimum level. They had worked fast, obviously terrified, and Johnson couldn't blame them. He wasn't quite as terrified, or so he told himself, but he also wasn't a fool. As a CO had told them at the briefing, the only people who didn't need to be afraid of this thing were already dead, so anyone who didn't want to join them had better get scared and stay that way. Some smartass, probably Danvers, who never missed a chance to mouth off, had wanted to know till when. Would that be all day, or for the rest of the week, or even longer than that? 'Cause I got plans for the weekend. "Until further notice, Private," the CO had replied. His voice had been so grave that the laughter died away immediately. "Until you hear from me personally that there's nothing to be scared of anymore. You want a ballpark figure, then I'd have to say, for the rest of your life, unless you don't want to be alive for a very long time." Johnson had never been so creeped out by anything, but at least it had shut that clown Danvers up. Nobody even heard him breathe loudly after that. Now he was even more creeped out as well as scared, having to guard this thing. But it could have been worse. Danvers could have been guarding this thing. His life and everyone else's in Danvers' hands. He'd have gone AWOL and the rest of the squad would have been right behind him. Putting one hand on his sidearm, Johnson walked a slow circle around the dais, watching carefully for any movement, even if it was a seemingly involuntary tick. It should have been too heavily trained even to remain conscious, let alone twitch, deliberately or otherwise. But it was awake. Very alert, too. Johnson didn't need to see that glint in its eye to know. He could sense it. Standing behind it, he'd looked the enormous misshapen figure up and down. Under the straitjacket, it still wore the tattered, filthy rags it had been captured in. Even if anyone had been reckless enough to make an attempt at stripping it, hosing it down, and getting it into clean clothes, there probably wasn't anything that would fit, short of a tarp with a hole cut in it for the thing's head. And that was assuming those rags would actually come off. It looked to Johnson like they had grown into the thing's flesh in layers that were years deep, as if whenever its clothing wore out, it simply put something else on over it and kept going. Kept hacking, that is, hacking away with its machete, as evidenced by the dirt upon stains upon stains upon dirt and so forth. Ad nauseam in extremis. Johnson didn't blame the medics for just leaving as it was. See that thing naked? No way, man. Not for all the money in the world. Johnson walked around to its other side and paused to survey it from a new angle. The IV was still stuck deeply and solidly into its neck, still pumping those tranks in. He had strict orders to call the medics if he saw even the slightest movement, because that would mean it was developing a tolerance and they would have to give it a stronger dose immediately. So far, he'd seen nothing. Well, nothing except that glint in its eye that let him know it was awake. However, he was seriously considering calling the medics and telling them that he had seen the thing move, just so they would up the dosage. What the hell? Why wait and put everybody's life at risk? Most especially his own. You just couldn't take chances with this thing, not unless you had a death wish. As Johnson moved around in front of it again, he thought he saw the glint in its eyes flicker slightly. like the thing had deliberately looked at him, like it was watching him from behind that dented, battle-scarred hockey mask, watching his every move whenever he was in its limited visual field. Jesus, when you look into the abyss didn't just look into you. It really kept its eye on you. The fucker actually had you under surveillance. No wonder nobody had removed his mask yet. Well, he had had enough of that shit. He went back to the pillbox and picked up the blanket he had been sitting on. He might have to watch this monster, but that didn't mean he had to go on actually looking at it for one more moment. Johnson tossed the blanket over the monster's head and then stood back, satisfied for the first time since he had drawn this shit duty. So much for the abyss. "Stare at that, you ugly son of a bitch," he said and turned away without noticing that the IV bag was swinging back and forth from the hook on the metal tree. Its vigorous movements were a result of the IV tube having been pulled loose from the monster's neck to dangle freely. Fluid dripped harmlessly out onto the floor.
Yeah, so Jason is in this facility, and they're going to cryogenically freeze him because, quite frankly, they can't figure out how to kill him. But, you know, it always happens when one scientist is like, well, he can't die. Let's delve into why, and maybe we can make people immortal. So they try to take Jason.
I love the military.
Yeah, and they go a little more into the story of Rowan, who's the head scientist who wants Jason frozen so he can't hurt anybody ever again, because there's plenty of evidence to say that he can. But this doctor, who is really pompous, just wants to do experiments. And as you can imagine, Jason gets out and starts killing everybody before he gets cryogenically frozen by Rowan, who inadvertently gets stabbed by Jason, breaking the seal on the cryo tube, which means they both get frozen. Now, this is a scene where the next scene is like 200, 300 years in the future, but in the book, it actually fills in that gap right there to explain, did the government know that shit went down? Do they know that there's a woman and Jason down there? Did they just say...
I always wondered that when I saw the movie. I was like, so nobody came after those guys died and she got frozen in there? And that was always kind of a thing that irked me about the movie. So before we get to that point, though, what did you think of Pat Cadigan's visualization of the of Jason killing these people? Because I felt like the whole scene where he's killing the people that are coming to take him away for testing, it was even more tense and maybe even a little more gory than what we got in the movie. And his showdown with Rowan before she gets him into the cryo tube was just so damn suspenseful. I thought Pat Cadigan... painted a real good picture with the suspense and stuff there.
That was really interesting when she's studying Jason, because Jason's a test subject here. She's been watching him for months, and she's just like, he only has four looks. Like, I'm about to kill you. I killed you. Where's my next kill? But then, like, he tilts his head at her, and she's like, huh.
That's new.
He's confused. Like, this is a different emotion from Jason. Like, I didn't think he could actually feel anything, but maybe he can.
Yeah, I didn't want to gloss over that because she painted this whole new picture, a whole other side of Jason that this person who has been studying him hadn't seen yet until he was free, you know? And it's like she was partially prepared to face off against Jason, but whenever he showed her a side that she hadn't seen, it made her more not as confident as she was a couple seconds before. Maybe I don't know him as well as I do. And we all know they have their showdown in the cryo room. And if she just wouldn't have taken the time to stand there and watch him freeze, you know, none of this would have happened. But she had to know. And I get that. She had to know. But yeah, go ahead and let's fill everybody in on the reason why she was left in there with Jason.
So apparently the government officials kind of realized that the situation was kind of handled. Everyone's frozen down there. Let's just lock up the facility and never come back. And then it shows the downfall of corporations and wars and all the stuff that led to Earth 1 being so polluted and destroyed that everyone had to go to a second Earth, which sets up the next section of the movie, which is the book, where they are, you know, student archaeologists that are coming back to Earth One to dig up relics, and that's where they find Jason and Rowan, like, hundreds of years later. And Pat actually colored this in better as well. Like,
yes, when you very see, much so.
When you see the kids, they're using, like, normal 2000s lingo, clothing, and she says that the professor who's running this expedition wanted to be authentic for Earth One, so that explains the dialogue, the clothing, because there are many times where they're like, they are going to, how do you say, make out. And it kind of reminded me of, do you ever watch Saturday Night Live where Chris Kattan tried to be Antonio Banderas and he had the, how you'll say, ah yes.
Yeah,
show.
Yeah.
That's what it reminded me of, because every time they're about to use slang, they'll be, how do you say, this. That kind of made me laugh. But yeah, each of the students that gets into this lab, you get a backstory on every student. Like, the one student with longer hair that's kind of like a stoner, they say he's a child prodigy. He's 17 years old, but he's a genius. He just makes dumb decisions. And then Janessa, the brunette, you know, she's really, like, rude.
I liked her more in the book than I did in the movie, Janessa. Yeah,
they give her more of a backstory there.
Yeah, like, I really felt bad when her time comes later. And same with Rowan, like I cared for her a lot less in the movie than I did in the book. And, like, in the movie, they didn't really give her time to, like, express, like, that vertigo-ish type feeling, you know? Like, because you know you would get all dizzy and stuff when you realize you're in space, you're 500 years in the future, you know? And in the movie, it didn't give her a lot of time to express how crazy that felt.
It's kind of like, yeah, that's a mild inconvenience. In the book, she kind of loses it, and they sedate her, which is pretty much how I think anyone would react.
Exactly, you know, or think they're full of, you know, that she's being, something else is going on. And another, while we're at this part, that it is students, another thing a lot of people that complain about this movie say, they're like, yeah, what is it, like, all these scientists look like hot teenagers and stuff? I don't get that. That's so stupid. It's like, okay, now you're showing me you didn't watch the movie, because they're not scientists, they're students. There's like one hot scientist, and that's the one that, actually, she's not even a scientist, she's a student too, so never mind. Yeah, they're students.
Yeah, and with the students is this android named KM. She's going to play out later on in the book, but they show that she was actually built by another one of the students. So it's a pretty interesting set of people, because KM is there to explain what's a hockey mask, what is this, what's that. So she's kind of like the, I don't want to say filler, because that sounds like a bad word, but she's the exposition. She is the exposition for the students to bridge the gap between the missing years.
And she was more fleshed out in the book, too, and more of a badass in the book. When that time comes, for sure. So, they find Jason frozen, and they find Rowan. And, of course, we all know they extract them, take them to the ship. And it's thaw-out time, man.
Yeah, before we get into that, one thing I want to say is that the professor, who's very arrogant and very obsessed with money and getting it, he was very similar to the head scientist who tried to take Jason in the beginning. So it's like, even if it's hundreds of years in the future, there's still people like this that only care about money, regardless of anyone's life.
Yeah.
So that's kind of interesting that he plays a human similar nature. Character. Although he's primarily motivated by money, whereas the other guy was just obsessed with, like, power and immortality. It doesn't seem like this guy really cares about that aspect of it.
And God, he is so even more easy to hate in the book, you know, because these characters get fleshed out more in a way where you're rooting for him more, or you're waiting for him to die more. And the professor was definitely one that I was like, eh, get
he reminded
I can't wait.
Me of, he reminded me of the teacher from Jason Takes Manhattan that was like, he was rude, you never liked him, and eventually Jason just picks him up and tosses him into like a bucket of trash or toxic waste and kind of drowns him. And I'm like, yeah, I was just waiting for that point to happen to the professor, like, at any point now. But on to another great character on the ship. I'm not sure why the ship has a private militia. I guess, were they worried about mutants on Earth One? I don't
know. They don't really explain. They're just there as, like, security or something.
I mean, they go into a lot of explanations in the book, but they didn't really explain why there's such all these people with machine guns, like, on a school trip.
I know, like, Marines or whatever, and Space Marines there with them. Yeah, that doesn't really explain. They're just kind of like inflated security service or something for these students going to... I guess because they're going for an extraction and stuff, in case they run into mutants or other, maybe pirates or something, space pirates, while they're on Earth, I don't know. But there's a whole team of them there on the ship.
Yeah, and the head of the team is a man named Brodsky, and Brodsky. He was an interesting character. We got a lot of backstory into him. He kind of reminded me of, do you remember in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3, Benny? Was the he was played by Ken Foray. He was the survivalist, the one that helped the main cast and actually went toe-to-toe with a lot of the Leatherface clan with guns. Yeah. That kind of strength that ran through him, I felt that a lot in Brodsky in this one.
Yeah, Brodsky was a badass in this book, man. Like, I loved his character in the movie, and even more so in the book. He was also kick-ass in Spartacus, the TV show. I was watching Spartacus a few years after Jason X. I was like, it's Brodsky! But yeah, loved him in the book. Loved his backstory. If you haven't read this book or listened to it, you should really, at the end of the video, click that thumbnail. The Brodsky backstory is really cool. It's a really cool extra they throw into the book. I don't want to give it away on the podcast. It's really interesting, though.
Yeah. On a side note, the ship that they get on is actually called the Grendel, which is interesting. I did a little research on that. I think it's a reference to Beowulf, the book.
Yes, it is.
In that book, Grendel was a hulking monster. They said he was a descendant of Cain. He was like a creature of darkness, cursed by God. He was just a destroyer and devourer. That's really Jason.
Yeah, look at what you got there. You got a hulking monster, and then you said it was like after Cain. I mean, I know it's Cain is in... the son of Adam and Eve, but, you know, Kane Hodder playing Jason. Little 6 degrees of separation there. That's pretty cool. Yeah, hulking monster. The Grendel is Jason, in a sense.
I mean, they don't really go into it in the movie, and they don't really
It was just thrown in, I'm sure, just to see if anybody caught it. But, yeah, that's a pretty cool reference.
I mean, while we're talking about ships, I mean, I know this happens later in the book, but since we're talking about ships, I did some research. The ship that saves them is called Tiamat. I didn't really find much on that. I found one reference that said there was a goddess in ancient Babylonian times. She was a symbol of primordial creation, also seen as a creator goddess. So maybe there's something there, like creation versus destruction. Maybe I'm reading too much into it. I just thought that might have been an interesting choice by them.
I can see that.
But now we're getting to one of the best scenes of the movie, in my opinion. Jason getting thawed out. Because they revived Rowan because they knew she was salvageable. But Jason, they just are like, this guy's dead. He's a chunk of flesh. Let's just leave him on a table and experiment on him. But he wakes up. And he goes back to doing exactly what he did before they froze him. Doesn't matter that he's on a ship, doesn't really care. And
Before you get there, man, I gotta say, I love this book, but there was one big thing that I did not enjoy about this book. And that was there was quite a bit of filler.
Yeah, I believe you actually said that, because I was re-listening to some parts of these, and I think you said that at the end of one of your reads. You're just like, there wasn't anything in this chapter that was really relevant to anything.
Yeah, it didn't need to be there, you know. They go into this whole chapter about Jason and how he is anti-life prior to him waking up here. And, like, she takes this theory that she's put together that could have been explained in, like, a paragraph and spreads it across a chapter. I did. That was a big complaint of mine going into it. But, like, she paints Jason as this anti-life being, that his whole purpose is to dispose of life. You know, any life, he has to put that flame out. And what did you think of that whole anti-life angle with Jason? Because it comes back in the sequel.
I mean, like you said, man, it was interesting. I feel that she's trying to add, like, a little sci-fi twist on the Jason. But at a certain point, you're right. It's just it she kind of kept coming back to the same point over and over. I mean, even when the other characters came up, I mean, even when you're learning about the professor's, like, gambling debts and stuff, the reason he went to salvage Jason in the first place, at least we were learning more about him. But with Jason, I felt like, you know, he's not that complex. I mean, if anything's around him, he kills it. That's just his thing.
We already
thing.
Knew that. I
don't really think we need to delve that deep into it, but it was interesting. I'm not saying that. I'm just, like you said, a little overkill.
Like to fill in some pages, maybe, you know, to meet that 400-page quota.
Yeah, that's probably why we got some of this.
And the scene is really cool, though. In the movie, of course, when he wakes up, it's awesome. But in the book, even more so, you know, because it's going back and forth between her working on stuff and Jason waking up. And really, really enjoyed that scene.
Yeah, I think we actually got a clip from that. Yeah, you want to roll that?
Yeah, let's do it.
In Lab 1, Waylander took a break from reviewing the data on the 21st Century Woman and wondered if he were the only person on the whole ship besides Lou and Crutch, who wasn't getting laid. In Lab 2, Adrian stared through the electron microscope at the sample of black ooze and wondered if she was losing her mind. This was the third sample she had taken, and the stuff was still all wrong. Therefore, she was going to have to conclude that the first two samples had not been anomalous due to some kind of contamination. Nor was there anything wrong with the microscope. Whatever this gunk was, it wasn't organic, and it wasn't inorganic. Nor was it a mixture of the two. It was as if someone had constructed a representation of a cell made out of artificial materials exactly to scale, and, despite the absence of any living components, the cell had somehow come alive, dividing in the standard cell fashion to produce the black ooze. Except it wasn't alive. It behaved as if it was, but it wasn't. There were none of the standard biochemical processes. The cells needed no oxygen or, as far as she could tell, anything else. It was like finding a rock that could grow, move, and initiate activity, but didn't need to breathe or eat. Except the crystalline rigidity of a rock was completely absent. A flexible rock? A resilient rock which, if you chipped a piece off, would regenerate the missing material? She sat back from the microscope and put the heels of her hands over her eyes, which had begun to water. It was quiet in the lab again. The vats were all full, so the liquid nitrogen flow had shut off. She had been so busy wondering if she were hallucinating that she hadn't even noticed. But now that she had, she was getting the creeps all over again. Now she could hear the drip, drip, drip of melting ice as the thing on the table continued to thaw. She glanced over her shoulder at it. Had it changed position since she had last looked? Or was it just that its clothes, no longer frozen stiff, were collapsing and resettling? All at once, she was very sorry that she had been so quick to get rid of Stoney and Kinsa. But seeing as how she had, certainly they must have had plenty of time to do whatever they had to do. Shouldn't they have been done by now and on their way back to resume their coursework? Sure, why not? These were the magnetic rabbits, after all. How long could they possibly take? She looked at the door. It stayed closed. Okay. She had to allow time for them to put their clothes back on, or dig something else out of their closets if they had gotten too energetic. They'd probably take a shower as well. Together, of course. But all right, so how long could all that take? That would depend on whether their getting clean together inspired them to get dirty all over again, she realized. Damn it. Her gaze wandered back to the creature on the table. There he is, she thought sourly. My date for the evening. She sighed and turned back to the microscope. Behind her, the thing on the table twitched for the first time. In fact, for the last several hours, Jason Voorhees had been, well, what was the right word? Conscious? Awake? Neither term seems applicable to anti-life. No longer dormant was perhaps closest to the truth. Finally, the stiffness that had held him prisoner in the deep freeze let go of him, and for the first time in over four centuries, he moved. Only a few clumsy twitches at first, since what passed for a central nervous system in him was not yet functioning well enough. Even though his body was neither really alive nor dead, it was still subject to certain limitations after being inert for so long. Meanwhile, the rage inside of him intensified. The creatures lived. He could sense them, sense their breathing, their hearts beating, their flesh growing warm, stretching, flexing. He sensed the nature of their thoughts and emotions, sensed the electrochemical reactions running along their nerves, sensed the contact all of them made with each other, the strongest of all being Kinsa and Stoney. If Jason sensed them, however, Kinsa and Stoney sensed nothing out of the ordinary, although ordinary is not a word either of them would have used to describe their lovemaking. Neither would they have described it as lovemaking for that matter, in spite of the fact that without realizing it, they had segued from pure gratification into the realm of emotion, while the Grendel was still on its way to Earth One. Exactly when they would realize it was completely unpredictable. Socrates may have been right in noting that the unexamined life was not worth living, but he could also have mentioned that a good many life situations should be given over completely to the act of living first and examine later. Both Kinsa and Stoney did this intuitively, which made them even more offensive to the embodiment of anti-life in Lab 2. It didn't help that Adrian's mind had wandered from the immediate task of gathering data to what she was going to do when the Grendel reached Solaris. She had been to all the orbiting cities several times, and Solaris was far and away her absolute favorite. It had the best clubs, the best food, the best music, and the best-looking guys. Even the maintenance staff were worth a second look or more. Perhaps she could actually sign out for a whole semester and explore hedonism for a change. She sighed. Or she could knock off the double talk for a change and just admit to herself that what she wanted was sex and plenty of it. She was probably the only person on the whole ship besides Lou and Crutch who wasn't getting laid. Adrian heard a noise behind her as if someone were getting up from the table, and she couldn't help jumping off the stool as she turned around. But there was no one there. Literally no one. The body on the table had vanished. She did not cry out in surprise or fear. It did not register that all of the sights that could have greeted her when she had turned around. This was the most impossible. Nor did she wonder how the hell it had happened. Adrian had only enough time to blink at the small bits of melting ice and dirt left behind on the empty steel surface. Then it had her. It was not that he had read her mind so much as simply that he understood the nature of her thoughts. Desire for company, for human contact. Desire to be desired, desire itself. Desire meant life, and life had to be wiped out. He grabbed hold of her hair, digging his thick fingers in deeply. She screamed in terror and pain as a good many of the long blonde strands were ripped from her flesh. Her flesh. There was entirely too much of that on display. Her silly, manicured claws tore at his fist, still buried in her hair. To no effect. He slammed her head against the console where she'd been sitting, and then yanked her backwards against another counter. This one had a great deal of breakable equipment on it, and she screamed even louder as some of the jagged fragments flying up in all directions hit her. Screaming, screaming, screaming. These creatures were always screaming. He became inured to screaming long ago. Quite often, screaming would quickly bring more victims to him, but so far no one else had come rushing into the room in a futile attempt to save the live thing. He already knew she wasn't alone here, wherever that was, so it had to be that no one could hear her. He tested that theory by hauling her across the room and smashing her face first against the glass portion of the wall between this room and the one next to it. There was no response to the woman screaming and pounding her fist on the glass, although he knew there was someone else on the other side. He knew where all the humans were in this strange place. He knew that they were all contained with him in a limited space. It made a smaller killing ground than he was used to. They would die faster. He yanked the struggling woman away from the window and dragged her across the room by her hair. She had dug out one of his eyes, and because he had still not been able to move, he had had to lie there and watch as she came towards him with that shiny tool in one hand, watch through his remaining good eye as she poked that long piece of metal into his eye socket, and felt around until she had found what she wanted. It hadn't taken her long to realize he was watching, but like all the rest of the shaved apes, she had refused to believe what she knew was true, simply because it would not have registered on one of the measuring devices in the room. Not that it would have mattered either way. He would still be killing her now. She had also removed his protective mask during the period when he was immobilized, but she had put it back. Unlike the eye, which she had frozen again, He had heard the tiny sound of it happening, the ruin of his eye instantly turning to cold crystal more brittle than glass. He didn't need the eye. The cells in the empty eye socket had regenerated enough to give him a form of sight. She could have gouged out his right eye and frozen that as well, and it would have more or less grown back, in a way. But she had violated him. Like all of her kind, all those pretty, self-involved, happy, horny young people who got everything they wanted, no matter what it was. Money, good looks, attention, all theirs. Just given to them. Once he had been human, but he had not been one of them. He had been something for them to laugh at, torment, even torture, or ignore as it pleased them. And there had been nothing he could do about it. Now he was no longer human, and he could do anything he wanted, including take away everything they had. Right now, he would start with the one who had violated him. He had not been able to see what she had done with his eye. But as soon as he spotted the sink full of mist, he had known somehow. Then as he dragged the woman closer, he could feel the cold coming off of it in waves, and he knew he had guessed right. The struggling, screaming woman seemed to understand what was going to happen. Her movements became more frantic the closer they got to the sink. Perhaps she was more open to believing what she knew now. Not that it would do her any good. Keeping a tight grip on her hair, he clamped his other arm tightly across her upper body and squeezed. And despite her screams, he could hear the sound of her sternum and ribcage cracking as he crushed her against himself. She was still screaming as he turned her body along with his around to the mist and plunged her face directly into it. Her scream acquired a liquid sound for the last second or two, before it cut off completely. He held her there a moment longer, and then yanked her upright again to see the results. The thick layer of ice and frost had obliterated her face almost completely, leaving only vague indentations to mark where her features were, except for her mouth, which was more defined because it had been wide open when it had frozen. It looked like a miniature shallow ice cave. He dug his fingers even more deeply into her hair, which had been left untouched, and slammed her head down on the counter next to the sink. Her face shattered into billions of sparkling pieces. When he lifted her head again, half of it was gone. There was only a raw red wound left behind. Satisfied, he discarded the body and moved towards a tray where a number of very shiny instruments had been neatly laid out. There were actually several trays with a variety of shiny instruments on them, but the ones on this particular tray were all bladed. He picked up the largest one and took a close look at it. Good metal, very sharp with a lethal curve to it, about the same size as his machete, which had gone missing. It didn't have the same kind of handle, but that was all right. It would still serve the same purpose. It would still do some serious damage.
Cool. Right. Yeah. So, yeah, now we're getting to the point of the story where it's just kind of like they're all trying to hunt down Jason. Jason's picking them up one by one. Not a lot different than the movie. It's pretty paint by the numbers here. Jason's going to kill everyone, and they're going to try to stop him. Now, what gets interesting is he kills the pilot, and where they're supposed to dock at the city, they kind of go straight through it, which was, I mean, that was a really, like, it was a really interesting scene. I know in the movie it was all just CGI and just going through like a fake city, but that's when things start getting serious because now not only is Jason on the ship, there's a time limit now. They have to get
the
off
stakes
this ship
are higher than
before
ever.
It explodes. Yes.
And Rowan is sitting here trying to tell the guy before Jason even wakes up, get him out of here, you know? And she knows, and nobody ever listens. You know, there wouldn't be a movie if they did. But, you know, the book gives even more detail of her plight to get them to get rid of Jason. And, it's just very intense scene we just listened to. And the aftermath is brutal.
There's actually something I want to bring up. I can't believe I skipped this. There is a line. I didn't catch it the first time I listened to this book. I caught it the second time.
Okay.
When Rowan wakes up, she goes through a lot of the, you know, who am I? Where are you? What are you people doing? But she says, like, where is he? And they're like, who? And she goes, Jason. And she, right before she gets sedated, she goes, then he's still out there. And I'm like, oh my God, she's repeating Alice's lines from Friday the 13th, part 1. Like, good not catch. Verbatim, but close.
Yeah, good catch. Good catch. Cool line. I'm sure that had to be what Pat Cadigan was going for. Had to be.
Love that.
Couldn't have just been a coincidence. I do love the scene in the book and the movie, the book even more so because of more detail, where Jason is just picking off these military personnel one by one, but also how whenever he is waking up, the whole sex scene happening, and how that's what brought him awake. I love that. That was just so... That was one of those cheesy awareness moments where the movie slash book knew it was being cheesy, but it went with Jason. You know, it was like a parody of itself.
It kind of wakes up like William Duvall. I love the smell of sex in the morning.
Exactly. That was funny. And but yeah, Jason picking off these military personnel one by one was even more badass in the book. Awesome. What did you think of this whole scene as the military grunts are being taken out by Mr. Voorhees?
I feel like it's interesting. It was very okay. I know in Jason Goes to Hell they ambush Jason and blow him up, but I feel like this scene is what would have happened if he saw them trying to trap him and he just started picking them off one by one. So I feel like this is like an alternate universe thing of if Jason Goes to Hell had like, you know, those like split decisions where you make a decision and then it branches off like an entire path. I feel like if Jason had seen it before he stepped in, Jason Goes to Hell could have gone a completely different trajectory.
Definitely. Definitely. I do like Jason Goes to Hell for what it is. It was very weird. That's one of those movies I didn't care for a lot when I was younger, but as an adult, I really appreciate what Adam did with that movie. And I enjoy watching it. It's one of those movies that grows on you. Jason X, I've loved from the first time I seen it. But yeah, you know, the Professor Lowe just keeps telling him, don't worry, don't worry. We got the military here. They're going to take care of them. They're going to take care of them. All the while, you know, Jason's just marking them off a list, man. And they even go into more detail, making us think that Brodsky's dead in the book more so than the movie.
More important.
Yeah, I thought they were changing it up in the book, to be honest with you, when I read that part. Because it really seemed like he was done for. Even though they used the same line.
Is that ought to do it.
That ought to do it, yep. Yep.
Yeah.
That ought to do it.
You know, now we're getting to the part of the book where, you know, you're wondering, I mean, you must have been wondering like me. It's just like, when is this guy with the metal face coming in? Like, we're more than halfway through this, especially when I'm watching it when I was a teenager. But
yeah, he only gets like a very short amount of time in the movie as Uber Jason. But the book gives us a more drawn out version of when they're all in the control panel area. And the military's personnel's taken out, and then bang, bang on the door. Jason's trying to get in, then it stops, and they're like, "Think he's gone? Won't you just stick your head out there and take a peek?"
And that's interesting because later on, he doesn't have to like bang; he could just knock doors off their hinges.
But the book does not disappoint when it comes to Professor Lowe and his. He just wants his machete back.
Yeah, or Jason's like can't quite decide between the new one and the old one.
Yeah. You want your machete? Oh, okay. Okay. You can have it, man. Woo! Oh,
I can make you rich.
I know he's sitting there offering Jason money and stuff. Look at who you're looking at. Is this guy like Jason's gonna take the mask off and go, really? You can make me rich. Okay. What are we talking, buddy?
Well, it's not just that. I mean, the thing that was going to make him rich was Jason. So it's like he's trying to bargain Jason
I'll
with
sell
Jason.
You and then give you. I guess they could like do like a space roadshow together or something and split the profits. You know, he could be Jason.
It kind of reminds me of the Jason Strain, where it's like that producer was like, "Babe, I can make you a star. I can get your own TV show." And Jason's just like inching on him, glaring
on the air on the airplane. Yeah.
I could make you a star.
Oh, my God. That guy was cocky till the end. No, that was, you know, that's another scene about that book I love. It's Jason in a fucking airplane, you know, in the Jason strain. So much about that book is great. And it's kind of like summer. Jason X Friday of the books because people shit on it. It's like a lot of people shit on that book because it's kind of like Jason in space. It's Jason in Costa Rica or whatever. But he fights a shark in that book and ends up in a plane explosion and stuff. I mean, shit. Anyways, and that was Krista Faust that wrote that that book, which is kind of obvious the way she really fleshes out the characters. But I'm getting way off topic here.
I know we both keep getting pulled like other Jason movies and books, but
so yeah, Jason. So now, Professor Lowe's dead, and the teens are trying to put together a plan. They find out. With the place they were gonna stop at being destroyed. And by the way, that scene where that space city gets destroyed, so much more detail, and it makes it seem so much worse because it talks about like the people that were on that in that city when it, you know, before it gets destroyed. And because in the movie it happens so fast, you don't stop to think. There's thousands of people. There's thousands of people there that are all dead now. Jason just killed 1,000 people by making the ship not have a pilot and then run into it like that. And they find out their hull is damaged, so they've got X amount of time to get someone to rescue them. But they've got Jason still there, and they put together a little plan, don't they?
Yeah, this is when things get kicked up a notch. KM, the android, gets an upgrade, and she kicks his ass, blows it off pretty much.
Let's talk about KM for a second, because the relationship between KM and her creator is a little more, should I say, fleshed out in the book. And that connection between them that's kind of joked about in the movie is a lot more... It's like accepted in the book, you know. People know that he's not just
her creator. He's actually in love with her, and
yeah, like even Rowan makes
a statement like, "Huh, you look so real," and she is, "I am real."
Like they even explain why he was putting nipples on her in the movie, you know, and they fall off or whatever. She was
actually
wanting
wants to look like everyone else.
Yeah, she wants to look like them so she can please him, and. It's really kind of sweet in a way, you know, and but yeah, we get Rambo KM.
I liked her a lot in the movie. The actress did a great job as KM.
Yes, very much so, very much so. And in the book, the whole fight scene with Jason is just amazing. I mean, it's awesome to see in the movie, but the book plays it out even more, and we get Jason's kind of reactions to what's happening to him. You know, not exactly an inner monologue into Jason, but sort of, as much as you can do that with Jason, as he's getting blown apart, you know, getting an arm blown off, a leg blown off, half his side blown off, his head. And they really think it's, you know, that they've killed him. Nobody stopped to think, wow, he landed on that nanoant table. I hope it doesn't malfunction. But they just leave him there, and they... come up with their plan to get rescued, and that is pretty much blowing half the ship off to buy more time for the rescue team to show up.
Blowing off your nose to save your face, right?
Exactly. Cut off your nose to spite your face, or whatever that saying is. And so rescue is coming. They're setting about this plan, and while they're doing that, the nano ants, which is explained more in the book than in the movie, start looking.
They're not really ants. They're just like holographic images to let you see what's going on that you can't see because they're microscopic.
Like
They repair. And it's interesting that this scene comes up because a kid loses his arm in the beginning, and I feel like he only lost his arm so they could show you there are these ants that can heal wounds, repair limbs, so that later on, when Jason gets shot, he falls on that table, and everyone's like, okay, he's dead, and they leave, and you're like, oh, he fell on the medical table! Oh my god!
Yeah, because Rowan, all the ants did for her was, like, heal her knife wound. But with the kid, it actually showed the arm being reattached. So... if they hadn't had that scene with the kid getting his arm cut off, you're right. All we would have saw is like it healing a knife wound. So we would have never thought it could have done, you know, fixed Jason. But I like how since it's all destroyed, it actually explains the computer saying, searching for non-organic material, you know?
And that actually explains Janessa. It explains that almost everyone on the ship had a hand in Jason coming back. Janessa was messing around with the setting that allowed her to cannibalize old spare parts to fill in gaps. So exactly. That filled in Jason's missing limbs. And the guy who ran the android, he didn't close the program to leave the ants in their holding place. So, and then KM broke, shot off Jason's leg, and he fell on the table. So all these people had a little hand in all
making
these
Uber.
Going wrong to bring Jason back to life, even stronger, more powerful than ever.
And as they're setting about their plans to blow half the ship, they get to meet Uber Jason. Go ahead.
It was interesting how they described him in the book, because they're saying that he's now truly anti-life, that this metal face is the face that he was supposed to be born with, and that they're like, this is his true face more than the flesh one he was ever born with, which I thought was kind of weird. I'm like, I don't think whoever designed that Jason, like, originally was like, you know, eventually he's going to have a, like, his face just isn't right. Like, he needs a better face, and then eventually it'll lead to a metal face. It was just a weird line.
I always wish we could have got Uber Jason in Friday the 13th, the video game.
If they ever finish that settlement, we might. I've seen, like, footage of it, but...
Here's the thing. A lot of people did get Uber Jason. About 6 months before he popped up in the game, which I'm going to get to, a lot of people took Part 8 Jason, and they made a skin out of the virtual cabin Uber Jason and put it over, like, Part 8 Jason and played as Uber Jason in the game. But then, a few months later, I'm talking like a month before the lawsuit shut off the DLC, Gun Media accidentally, in an update, gave like a third of their PC players Uber Jason selectable by accident. Yeah. So he was in the game for real with his real kills and everything. They took him out of the game, and here's the thing. When they took him out, like 2 weeks later, they got shut down from putting out DLC. So if they had just left that one that they, the real Uber Jason in, that they had accidentally released, if they had just left him in there, they could have left him in the game and just done bug fixes on him to finish him off. But since they put him in and took him out, they couldn't re-add him as DLC after the lawsuit. But if they had just left him in there, because they patched him out after they accidentally put him in the game, if they just left him in there, we might have not ever got the Grendel map, but we could have had Uber Jason. They could have, because they can still do bug fixes, and they could have left him in there and just done bug fixes to finish him off, whatever was missing. Like, I think his music was missing. They were going to use the score from the movie.
Someone got, because I tried to get the soundtrack, someone took, I don't know where they got this music, man, but it was like a warped version of an uncut music piece for Uber Jason, and it was freaky, man. Like, I have never been able to find this music piece on YouTube. I guess they took it down, but to me, that is like Uber Jason's theme. It's freaky. I gotta let you listen to it sometime, but...
There's a couple people that sell, apparently, like, code that you can put into your files if you have the PC version of the game, where you can still play as Uber Jason. I don't know how to do all that technical stuff, but I've seen people still do that to this day. But that game, I feel like, is even if they end the lawsuit now, they're probably just going to have to make another game. So yeah, now our cast of characters is going to meet Uber Jason.
Reminiscent of Jason Takes Manhattan, right when Uber Jason comes out to see the woman that destroyed him a few minutes ago, she just turns around to the others and is like, y'all probably better run, and he punches her head clean off her shoulders.
Let's play a clip of them meeting Uber Jason.
Impossible, Waylander yelled. Rowan had a glimpse of him shaking his head slowly from side to side before she turned around completely. He's dead! He's dead! I'd say he got better, Rowan heard herself say faintly. He's been modified, KM remarked, her tone surreally conversational. as if they were all chatting over coffee. "Oh, well, gosh, you think?" Janessa said shrilly. "Can you take him?" asked Cineron. Rowan turned to look at him in utter confusion. Then Kayan was hauling her to her feet and pushing her towards the safe end of the walkway, and she realized that Cineron's question had not been meant for Janessa. "I can try," KM said, walking towards the impossible nightmare that stood in the open doorway. Rowan watched as she drew both sidearms and fired. Were the rounds bouncing off or disintegrating, Rowan wondered, and did it make any difference either way? "He's been modified." KM holstered her weapons and threw herself forward in a series of powerful flips, stopping directly in front of Jason and kicking his head. Nothing happened. "He's been modified." KM kicked him twice more. With an easy, almost casual movement, Jason put a hand around KM's neck. She had just enough time to look over her shoulder and say, in a maddening, reasonable way, "You guys might want to run." Then Jason brought his other fist up, and suddenly KM's head was half bouncing, half rolling on the floor. It came to rest with her calm, pretty face looking directly at all the rest of them with an expression that seemed to say, "Why are you still here?" Chapter 21. KM! Cineron dived towards the android's head as Jason discarded the rest of her with a careless flick of his wrist. His new, improved wrist. "Don't forget, he's been modified," Rowan's mind prompted, echoing the insane matter-of-factness of the last few things KM had said. "He's been modified. I can try. You guys might want to run." Yes, indeed, she might very much want to do exactly that. Run like mad without stopping, Rowan thought, watching as the Uber-Jason advanced on Cineron, who was cradling KM's head in his visibly shaking arms. In truth, she most definitely wanted to run like hell without stopping right now. In fact, there would probably never be a better time for something like that. Running like mad without stopping than right at this moment. By now, Jason was raising his machete, his new, improved machete. No less modified than any other part of him, and preparing to bring it down in an arc that appeared to be directly in line with Cineron's neck. Preparing to cut off his head as well. Because two heads were better than one. So yeah, she might want to run now. Then she hurled herself forward. She caught Jason's arm with both hands and incredibly held it in midair just short of mid-stroke. Held it? No, not exactly, not hardly. What she had done was surprise the hell out of the monster to the point of distracting him from completing his intended action, thus saving Cineron's life, or more likely just adding a few seconds to it. Hadn't added any to her own, though. Jason's big left hand was wrapped around her throat now, and she dangled from his fists like a rag doll, her feet several inches above the metal floor, gasping for air as she felt him tighten his grip, his new, improved, modified grip. "Don't you know?" whispered some psycho voice in her head. Rowan tugged at his hand with both of hers, and then suddenly found herself staring directly into his eyes. She had never been so physically close to Jason before, she realized, not even centuries ago when he had killed her. He had red eyes now, blood red, burning and brutal, as inhuman and unpitying as the beaten and scuffed piece of impassive white plastic that had hidden his face before, and the bizarre steel artifact that had replaced it now. The thing was strapped to the front of his head like a mask, but it was not impassive, not in any way. Nor did it really hide anything. This was no disguise. This was something from a nightmare, realm of gargoyles and grotesques and grisly death. This was Jason Voorhees' true face, more than anything else ever had been or ever could be, even the flesh and blood features he had been born with. No, especially those, because this was not simply the real face Jason had always worn when he looked at the world. It was the face that the world had shown Jason. Dark patches started to swim through Rowan's vision as the hand around her neck squeezed even more tightly, and she wondered if she were going to suffocate before Jason got around to cutting her head off. Or maybe, compared to his new improved modified state, she was now too insignificant a creature for that kind of death. But even as everything continued to go dark around her, she could still see those burning red eyes glaring, boring into her. He remembered her. He knew who she was and what she was. Like all the rest of his victims, she was each and every hateful thing that had ever hurt him in any way and to any degree, whether slight or great. All at once, she found herself flat on her back on the floor, holding her bruised throat and breathing in and out in great panting whoops. Somewhere behind her, Janessa was screaming something about running right now. And Brodsky, where the fuck are you? And Waylander, no, no, don't! Rowan raised herself up on one elbow, holding her neck with one hand, and had a brief glimpse of Jason standing over her and struggling with someone who had grabbed him from behind. Get out! Waylander was hollering. Get out now! Run! Run! She pushed herself to her knees, her breath coming a little easier now, but the muscles in her throat so painful now that swallowing brought tears to her eyes. She blinked them away just in time to see Jason yank Waylander off his back and fling him away. Waylander flew several feet through the air, hit the wall hard, and slid down to the floor with the lower half of his body twisted around in a way that meant he could not be getting up again. No! Rowan moaned, and Jason turned to look at her again. At the same moment, someone grabbed hold of her roughly and half-pulled, half-dragged her to her feet. She tried to reach for Waylander, but he shook his head emphatically. Go! Run! Get out now! He shouted. Rowan was horrified to see blood glistening on his lower lip. Janessa was pulling her towards the now open door on the safe side of the walkway, all the while screaming for Brodsky. Even as they stumbled through the door together, it was closing again. Still clutching KM's head, Cinaron dived through the steadily shrinking gap barely a moment before it would have been too small for him. Janessa had stopped screaming for Brodsky and was now simply screaming in wordless terror at the door to walkway B, as if she believed screaming would somehow fortify the door. What's the matter? Brodsky seemed to materialize in the midst of them out of nowhere. What the hell's going on? Jason fucking Voorhees, that's what's going on, Rowan said, grimacing at the pain in her throat. Something put him back together again. Brodsky went to have a look through the thick glass window in the door. Jason's new still face appeared on the other side, and Rowan tried to cry out and warn Brodsky to step back. The door wouldn't protect him no matter how thick or strong it was. She had done the same thing once, and Jason had stuck a blade in her gut. And that was before he'd been new and improved and modified. Something pounded against the door hard enough to send vibrations through the chamber they were in. Blow the charges! Yelled Brodsky. We can't, Janessa told him tearfully. Waylander's got the trigger. Time came to a complete stop. Well, if this isn't the friggin' pits, or whatever they used to say back in the 21st century, Waylander thought, struggling to remove the detonator from his belt. Good thing he'd only broken his back when the big son of a bitch had tossed him at the wall. If he'd broken his neck, he wouldn't have been able to do anything except lie there and wait for things to wind up. Not that he particularly wanted to die at that moment. More than anything, he wished he could have been on the other side of the door with everyone else. But since things had broken the wrong way for him, so to speak, he was just going to have to make the best of a bad situation. Fortunately, he hadn't been left completely without alternatives. Even if he wasn't going to get out of this with everybody else, he still had a say in how things ended. He didn't have to just lie there in a crumpled, broken heap and take whatever was coming up next. But goddamn, it hurt so much to move, even just a little bit. Pulling the detonator off his belt felt like there was someone wrapping barbed wire around his insides and then pulling it tight. Finally, the small black box was in his hand. A wave of dizziness went through him as he held it up to look at it, and he knew he was very close to passing out. He had to get this thing done, fast, now. No more screwing around. Hey! Asshole! He called, raising his voice as best he could in spite of the agony. Jason turned away from the door and looked at him. Waylander broke into a broad grin. Hey, at least you know your name, asshole. He held up the detonator so that Jason could see it. Maybe the bastard knew what it was, maybe he didn't. What the hell? Then, still grinning, he pressed the button. Time started again with a tremendous explosion that knocked them all off their feet. Rowan found herself irrationally trying to cling to the floor as it tilted violently, first one way and then the other.
But of course they find out you can't defeat Jason that easy, especially Uber Jason. Here's another clip.
She wanted to tell them to close the door, to beg them not to let her die, to tell Rowan she was the bravest person she'd ever known, to tell Cineron that it hadn't all been just a game with her, that she'd actually started to develop real feelings for him, to ask Brodsky to remember her as more than just a sex goddess, to please, please, please do something. Couldn't the Tiamat save her somehow? Her fingers loosened, and she blurted out the first thing she could think of. Oh, this sucks on so many levels! Then she let go. If Brodsky had not yanked her back into the corridor, Rowan would have seen it happen, and she knew it. How he had found the strength to drag her out of the chamber in one fiercely powerful motion astonished her, almost as much as the fact that he managed to do it without dislocating her shoulder in the process. She had a glimpse of Brodsky's face in passing. The expression on it terrified her. Cineron screamed Janessa's name, and suddenly the roar of the wind cut out almost completely, just for the briefest of moments. There was the hideous, wet sound of flesh and bone forcibly ripping, cracking, tearing, shredding, impossibly fast. Then the roar of air escaping through the hole swelled again. Unable to help herself, Rowan turned to look, and almost immediately averted her gaze. There was very little left on the metal grating, only a few unrecognizable tatters of the very, very partial remains of a very pretty, slightly spoiled young woman, whose temperament had actually been a good deal sweeter and more vulnerable than she had ever let on to anyone else. All at once, the roar of the wind began to fade away, along with the relentless pull of the vacuum as Brodsky closed the door. Working after all, Rowan thought dully, as Brodsky hustled her towards the cargo bay. Lucky us. Lucky, lucky us. They had escaped into the rest of the ship by the time Jason punched his way through the wall into the chamber. The atmosphere gone now, he floated across the room, raised his machete to hack through the door, and then paused as his new, improved, modified eyes caught sight of the controls on the wall. The ants had not had much to work with in terms of higher brain function, but his capacity to use tools had required only a little enhancement. His brain replayed the last few minutes, lingering over the violent expulsion of the girl's pulped bone and tissue through the metal grid. Death, yes, but only death, not by his hand. No murder, no rage, no fear, no meaning. Now the rest of them were elsewhere in the ship. He could feel them even from outside in total vacuum, just as he could feel the approach of others like them, coming to save them, or so they thought. If he crashed through the door and destroyed it, there would be no one struggling to resist the vacuum except himself. He was strong enough, that was no problem, but it would take longer to get to them. Jason opened the door, pulled himself through it with only a little effort, and closed it behind him. Now they were securely trapped in the ship with him, waiting for the others to arrive.
Okay, the stakes are high now.
Yes, and this even sucks higher than they were before. I would say the stakes suck on so many levels.
Yeah, poor Janessa.
We, of course, care about her more in the book than in the movie, at least I did. And it sucked to see her go. But this is about the time. This is about the time that we find out that Brodsky did not bite the bullet. And the whole scene, Brodsky and Rowan have a deeper connection in the book than the movie. Like, if he hadn't died, I can see them like being together, you know, after it all was over with. So yeah, Brodsky's back. Rowan is so happy. And Brodsky, is helping Rowan and them get out while they're having to seal that room up because Uber Jason had punched through the whole thing that killed Janessa. And it's like they get him through, they seal it off, and, you know, here comes the rescue. You know, it's like it's so intense. In the movie, it's like the last, 15 minutes of the movie? But in the book, man, it is so more intense how they set up everything. And, what do you think of this part? Janessa's bit the bullet, Brodsky's back, Jason is back in the ship. They've got him sealed off for now.
And that's the problem, because you know, they used to be able to seal him out. Now he's just keep kicking down doors. I mean, if you saw the trailer like I did, you're hearing drowning pools, let the bodies hit the floor, as he's just knocking down doors and looking badass with sparks flying everywhere. That's the scene we're in right now.
I wish I had used that song somewhere in the audiobook, man, other than the intro. I know I used it in the intro at least a few times, but God, I wish I had used that in the background during this book. I thought I did, but maybe I didn't.
For your re-releases, man. For your re-releases.
Yeah. Well, this one, I think I used some sound effects and background music in, didn't I?
Yeah, you did. But the one you do them now, you use like a lot more
background
music. So, I mean, you can always go back and like repolish it, but it worked fine for me. Who knows when we get the video game soundtrack that actually has Uber Jason in it? You know, we could always like, or you can always like add that music back in the book. If that video game level ever gets finished and released.
Oh, God, that'd be cool. Because some of the books, I've actually used the music from, like Part 8 Jason and Part 2 Jason from the game in some of the books.
Part 9 Jason is a really good piece you've used a couple times. I love the video game soundtrack, which was also composed by Harry Manfredini in most of the franchise. So that made the soundtrack even cooler, because you get to hear all these new themes he's cooked up over the years.
Yes, and I love the Tommy tapes and the Pamela tapes from the game, but that's a topic for maybe after the slash. I really enjoy how they're setting up, because they know at this point, the rescue team's there, they got to get this airlock open, you know, and Brodsky's going to go work on that. Very suspenseful, just him working on that. They know they can't beat Jason, so they decide, they can't beat him physically, so they decide to distract Jason. And in the movie, it happens so quick, but in the book, it's so funny how they're sitting here trying, KM and him are trying to set up the hologram. Because that's something we didn't talk about. That's something I want to talk about for a second. We kind of glossed over it. Yeah, we glossed over that earlier, but we'll go ahead and talk about it for a second. I loved in the book whenever they were playing the video game in the holodeck. That was really fun because it talked about how Jason saw that giant monster, alien monster, and it was like his reaction to it was pretty cool. Just cutting it down, and then he kills those two guys while they're in the game, and then he sees them again.
Cut.
Game over, man. And then he sees him again, and it's like head tilt Jason. Like, what the fuck? But, you know, we'll probably talk some of that after the slash. But I always loved that scene in the movie, and they did a great job of that in the book. Pat Cadigan did. Made it even more fun when Jason comes in and kills that alien monster and then has to kill them twice apiece. But that leads us to where we're at in the book now. They're going to use that program to try to buy themselves some time. And KM setting up the whole, you know, circa 1980s Crystal Lake. It was just funny, the dialogue there when they were setting it up. And Rowan's like, you might want to hurry the fuck up. And it's crazy that Rowan, like, gets a throwaway line in the movie and the book about using guns. It's like riding a bicycle, but it's like a totally different gun than she's ever seen.
Yeah.
And then she's, like, helping them work on getting the airlock going, and it's like, this is technology that's 500 years more advanced than her, but she just jumps right on it.
They do go in the book a little bit how she's really nervous and she's having to take step-by-step instruction from Brodsky,
and that makes it more suspenseful. But I love how he's like trying to calm her down. He's out there doing his thing, talking her through it. So Jason is all of a sudden out of the spaceship and he's back at Crystal Lake.
Yeah, and he's back to familiar surroundings, and of course they had to make some virtual campers to actually lure him in, or no, I guess camp counselors, I should say. It's like, you smoke some pot and have some premarital sex,
and I got to voice him. Smoke some pot? I'll have some premarital sex? So, you know what? Let's just play a clip.
Roll it.
Oh my God, she thought, almost dropping the terminal and wires in shock as the colors began to solidify into definite shapes. Oh my God, they did it. Cineron and KM actually did it. They actually recreated Crystal Lake. chapter 24. It was not wonder that Jason Voorhees felt as Crystal Lake shimmered into existence around him. He was not even confused, not really. Not in the sense that any living intelligence could feel confusion or bewilderment to the point of questioning circumstances and events. For anti-life, nothing was ever in question. But it was for that very reason that Jason could be distracted, even in his new, improved, modified state. The new cleverness the ants had bestowed on him for making use of more sophisticated tools had nothing to do with imagination. Even after all the improvements and modifications, there were still only five elements: himself, his prey, his weapons, his obstacles, and his killing ground. If he thought anything at all about his surroundings now, it was only that this was a killing ground familiar to him. He turned in a slow circle, taking in the gently rippling lake, the woods, and the clearing where he was right now. There was a small birch tree near the shore, the bark peeling away in layers here and there. Just at the point where the trunk divided in two was a heart with initials inside which had been carved clumsily into the wood. There were mere hearts and initials cut into a weathered wooden chair a few feet away. It was stuck into the ground right next to a stone path. Jason followed it with his eyes and saw that it led up to the front door of a cabin. All at once, the afternoon sunlight was gone, and it was the middle of the night, complete with sound effects. Had Jason paid attention to such things? It might have occurred to him that the cricket and frog population seemed to have increased by a factor of 10 since the last time he had been here. What he did notice was the moon, which appeared through the trees directly in front of him. It was close to the ground and about the size of the cabin, if not bigger. He had never seen the moon that way, but it all meant to him was that the prey would have more light to see by. Hefting his machete, Jason took a step towards the cabin and then hesitated. No one there. In the woods, then. He stood motionless, his head lift tilted and tipped to one side, ignoring the wind rustling in the trees as well as the overdone nocturnal chorus. When he had first prowled this killing ground, his ability to sense prey had been nowhere near so well developed. In the beginning, it had felt sometimes as if he were smelling them, and other times as if he were hearing them. Later on, it was more like he could smell the sounds they made. Eventually, he simply knew what he knew. Had the long-dead Dr. Aloysius Wimmer or any of his late contemporaries been able to study Jason in depth, they might have discovered that his mechanism for sensing live humans operated in a way that was vaguely analogous to how a hay fever sufferer detected the presence of ragweed, or not. It might never have occurred to them that they could not take an approach to understanding him in terms of something that was alive. Ironically, this meant that in some respects, Jason Voorhees actually had a better comprehension of the nature of life than any human being ever would. With the possible exception of KM, that is, she had retained a complete understanding of everything involved in the process of becoming human. Although, like any other human being, she lacked even a rudimentary vocabulary to articulate it. However, this did enable her to create a holographic representation of Crystal Lake that was completely convincing, despite certain variations from the original, some of which so glaringly obvious that Jason would not have paused to look twice on his death march to the shuttle bay. She knew, of course, that he would not question the reality of being on the Grendel in one moment and then back in Crystal Lake in the next. But he would not be distracted unless he sensed the imminent presence of human life in his immediate surroundings. More than simply drawing on topographical data and interpolating the details of flora and fauna, she had to imbue the place with an overall atmosphere, an ambience that Jason would take to mean that humans could be hunted and killed here. After some time, Jason took a few steps towards the cabin, peering past it into the shadowy edge of the forest. Then he turned and moved down to the waterline. He waited again before suddenly turning to his left and striding quickly along the stone path, away from the cabin. He had only gone a few yards before he stopped again. Something was very, very wrong here. For the first time, he could feel his prey actually eluding him. This was not how it worked. How it worked was he sensed humans, he went to where they were, and he killed them. Usually, they ran to another location, but that didn't matter. Once he sensed them, he knew where they were, regardless of how they changed direction, trying to escape him. They did not vanish from his awareness as he moved towards them, and then suddenly register on his senses as being somewhere else entirely. That did not happen. It couldn't. There were humans here. Everything he was told him there were definitely humans here. And there were also humans nearby. The ones he had been hunting when he had suddenly returned to the old killing ground. He still felt them, and when he moved towards them, nothing changed. As he started walking back towards the cabin, he saw everything in front of him ripple like water, once and then twice more. Now there seemed to be a light in the window. Someone was inside after all. No, not inside. He was actually looking all the way through the cabin and out another window at something in the forest beyond. He skirted the cabin and suddenly, a small flight of stairs appeared in the shadows, along with a metal platform and an entryway to an area where a man was standing in front of some equipment. A woman's head was attached to it. Jason recognized that head at that same moment that the man looked up and saw him. "Oops," Cineron said. Rowan looked up sharply from the two diodes she was holding in either hand. Brodsky had told her she had to use the blue one, but they both looked blue to her. "What do you mean, oops?" She glared at Cineron's back, trying to will him to turn around. He didn't. Nothing, he said quickly. "Not nothing. You don't just say, oops. What oops?" Rowan demanded. Cineron let out a heavy sigh. "I think he saw me." "Wonderful," Rowan groaned. "If you got something brilliant up your sleeve, now's the time to do it." "I got something," Cineron said. "Kay, are you still with me?" she said genuinely. "Okay. Repair variations using data file Crystal Lake, 1980. There was a brief pause. KM frowned thoughtfully, her eyes moving from side to side. "Ready. Here goes nothing." Rowan was no longer listening. Her gaze fell on the diode she was holding, and suddenly she could see that the one in her left hand was turquoise, not blue. The difference between them was so incredibly obvious that she couldn't understand how she hadn't seen it right away. "Hey, you!" Jason whirled. The two giggling females were standing in a grassy area with the moon right behind them, wearing nothing but little belly shirts and panties along with their big mindless smiles. One of them held up a bottle and wiggled it at him. "You want a beer?" she asked, giggling some more. "Or do you want to smoke some pot?" added the other one, producing a joint. "Or we could just have premarital sex," said the first one cheerfully. He stared as they tossed away the beer and the joint to pull their shirts off over their heads. Topless now, they each struck a pose as if they were having their pictures taken. "We just love premarital sex," they said in unison. Jason raised his machete and advanced on them. But instead of screaming and running away, they only climbed into a pair of sleeping bags lying on the grass behind them and continued to giggle as heartily as ever. He bent over and took a closer look at them. They registered as live humans, but oddly, were these the ones he had sensed eluding him before? Why didn't they do that now if they could, or scream and run? Defective. They were defective, like him, when he had been a living creature. No, not like him. They were happy. No one would want to hurt them. That settled. He zipped them into their sleeping bags and bashed them alternately against each other in a nearby tree. Finally, they started squealing and screaming, and they kept it up long after other humans would have stopped. He would not have cared how long it went on, except that in between, they were also still giggling. Then she heard Cineron say, with new panic in his voice, "He's done with the campers!" "Already?" replied KM, calm but impressed. "Wow, he's good." "Too good," Cineron said. "He's coming back!" Rowan turned towards the cargo bay and saw him standing against the incongruous backdrop of Crystal Lake. She noted absently that it was amazingly authentic, just not authentic enough to keep Jason occupied long enough to let them get away. He started moving quickly towards the shuttle bay again, reaching down to grab his machete without having to pause.
I think everyone's favorite part from that clip is that Jason used one girl in a sleeping bag to beat the other girl in a sleeping bag to death, which was very reminiscent of one of the most famous scenes in Friday the 13th, that scene from Friday the 13th Part 7, The New Blood, which
where Jason
was battling a psychic girl.
You know, in part seven, they cut it down from like seven swings to one. In this one, it's just bam, bam, bam. And you know they drug this scene out because it got cut back in part seven.
You know, it was kind of cool. I mean, this is something we can talk about in After the Slash, where Kane Hodder, who did this with the sleeping bags, he actually had to do all the moving and recording for Jason in the video game. So there's all this behind-the-scenes footage of him in green screen, like, hitting people with sleeping bags and lifting heavy objects and stuff. So it's cool just to see him in a green room just tearing a bunch of stuff up.
Kane Hodder is the man. Kane Hodder is going to be my all-time favorite Jason. Him and Derek Mears did amazing as Jason.
Which is actually interesting because they fight each other in Hatchet 3. Kane Hodder is Victor Crowley, and Derek Mears is the head SWAT guy that's trying to take him down. So they go head to head.
And in Hatchet 1, Robert Englund is the guy in the boat that dies towards the beginning of the movie.
Yeah, Jason killed Freddy pretty quickly.
Yeah, so we got a Kane versus Robert. So anyways,
sorry for another time.
Really getting off subject tonight.
That's so easy. Now they're in the escape. They're trying to get to the escape pod, and there's always something that's gonna go wrong. Like I can't get the door open. To build that suspense. And Jason's coming after him because he killed the holograms. So they're like, wow, that didn't take much time at all.
Remember the oops? I think he saw me. Because in the movie, it don't explain it, but in the book, it explains kind of like how Jason looks over and sees him through, like, the window of the cabin, you know, punching at the computer. And so they're all running down this tunnel, because Brodsky and Rowan finally got the door open, and they're running down this tunnel, and it's like, don't forget KM's head! So, you know, Rowan had to go back and get the head, and it's badass in the movie, just as badass in the book. Jason's just walking towards that tunnel. You know, this is it. You guys are fucked. Gonna wipe you out. And here comes Brodsky shutting the door, man. I love that scene, whether it's in the book or in the movie, where Jason's standing at the end of that hallway about to go after him, and all of a sudden, the door starts closing, and he looks over, and Brodsky's standing there, sacrificing himself, shutting the door.
And then they do that iconic scene of them walking at each other from one's from the left side of the screen, one's from the right side, and they just like bam, right when they hit, the ship explodes.
Exactly.
You think it's all over, and then they look out the window of the spacecraft, and Jason's flying through space.
You gotta be fucking kidding me.
Yep. That's when Brodsky knocks Jason in a trajectory going into Earth where he's gonna burn up in the atmosphere going down, which should be the end of Jason, but
sets up four sequels
where his melted hockey mask just goes down into the new Crystal Lake, which was just a cool image of like his mask in the water. And you know that even though there's no body in that mask, he still comes back somehow,
which is cool though, because you know we can go ahead and touch on that for a second. That when the experiment begins, Jason X2, the experiment, it picks up where this leaves off. It picks up with that mask laying at the bottom of this lake, and you find out like two nano ants had survived. And I'm not going to say anything more until we have that episode. But yeah, those things can reproduce and stuff and multiply. But it had to be a crazy feeling when all this was over, you know, because Rowan, she's from 500 years ago, and she's on her way to Earth 2 now. And it was kind of cool to see, like, these campers looking up and seeing a falling star, and it was the mask, you know, and it lands into the lake. It had to be a lake.
Even 500 years in the future, things still haven't changed. There's still campers out of lake and doing all sorts of sinful things.
God, it would have been so cool if Rowan could have popped up somewhere in one of the sequel books. That would have been so awesome.
I thought she was the girl from the second one, but she, like, changed her name or something.
It would have been cool if that was her, because I thought it was her at first, too, man. Like, she'd got a new job or something.
Yeah.
It would have been cool if they would have at least mentioned her. I would have loved to see her run into Jason later. But, yeah, final thoughts on the novelization, man. We know how we both feel about the movie, but novelization, final thoughts.
Okay, final thoughts. I like how they explain some of the things that weren't explained in the movie. How Jason got out of his chains in the beginning. I like how they explain how they brought him back. But, I mean, it is a Black Flame novel. They do have to add a bit of fluff in there. And just, there have been some novelizations. I know I keep saying this, but I love the novelization of A Nightmare on Elm Street 3, how it was based on an earlier script. So there were different kills, there were different characters.
That's kind of a lot of things that were
from the movie. But with Jason X, it's kind of like a paint by the numbers thing. I mean, if you've seen the movie, you read the book. I mean, yeah, Janessa is just this ditzy brunette in the movie. But in the book, she was a scientist that was trying to create new plants. And the kid with the long hair that you thought was a stoner actually designed a holographic video game. But they still died in the exact same way. So it didn't really matter. A lot of different. The book.
I gotta say, man, I completely agree, and I really can't say anything extra. Everything that Sean just said, I feel the same. Definitely, guys, check out the book. We're not saying because it's paint by numbers that it's not entertaining. It's a great novelization for being a almost carbon copy, but there is a few little extra goodies there that you might enjoy, even if some of them in the end doesn't really make a big difference. And it set the ending. Gets picked up right where it leaves off whenever we get to Jason X number 2, The Experiment, also written by Pat Cadigan, which was a good idea to have the same author write the direct sequel. We got a lot to talk about over on After the Slash. If you're not a patron already, sign up for as little as $2 to $5 per month, and you can catch our after show, After the Slash, every time we have a podcast here on Out of Print Slashers. Thank you so much for listening. Sean, thank you for being here with me tonight.
There's one last thing we got to do before we go.
We got
a star system now.
Yep, here we go. I give this book 3 out of 5 stars. Love the movie, love the book, but I can't give it any more than 3 because it doesn't really give me any extra.
Yeah, I mean, I give it 3.9. Like, I mean, if there was like something different, I would have given it like 4 out of 5 or maybe 5 out of 5, but. Just being fair. A kind of a carbon copy of the movie, it didn't have that, you know, the extra little spice to kind of kick it up a higher rating. So I'd say about 3.9.
That's fair. So me, I'm 3. He's at 3.9. Let us know what you think in the comment section. Click the thumbnail at the end and check out the audiobook. And until next time, this has been the 80s Slasher Librarian saying, okay, kiddies, thanks for listening. Pleasant dreams! And we'll see you next time.
And this has been Sean Campbell saying, don't move, or I'll blow the hole the size of a Kansas City watermelon through your ugly-ass metal face.
All right, guys. Have a great night. Click that thumbnail. It should be there right now.